I'm Karole Armitage. I'm a choreographer, which might sound unusual, but you will find out why I'm here soon. And my affiliation is the Armitage Foundation, which produces contemporary ballet.
Hi, I'm John Harte. I'm an external faculty member at the Santa Fe Institute, and I'm a professor at the University of California, Berkeley. I'm an ecologist and trained originally in theoretical physics.
You know, I've been very interested in ways in which the frontiers of science, in a way, ideas, conceptual material from science can inform the creative process in the arts. Because pushing the boundaries is what I'm interested in. And so there are a lot of really profound ideas that exist in science that can contribute to how we think about time and space. And what is dance? It is time and space. It's the architecture of time and geometry written on the air in space and moving through space. So in the last 10 years or so, I've tried to develop dance projects that have a scientific basis content. And John was generous enough and has the creative powers himself to have a great interest in the arts and an ability to speak in the language of the arts as well as science. And I'm not even sure the genesis, but somehow or other, there came this idea of doing a work on time.
Well, Karole and I have spent many, many summers, many decades of summers, at a place called the Rocky Mountain Biological Laboratory in Colorado. And we were at a dinner party, I think it was probably a dinner party together, and the subject of time came up, and Karole was expressing interest in the idea of dance as expressive of time. And I mentioned to her that the Santa Fe Institute had a fascinating funded project to explore the many dimensions of time, and that most of that funding was going into scientific dimensions. But I said, I bet they'd be interested in combining ballet and science in some sort of creative act. And I said, I would talk to my colleagues at the Santa Fe Institute and see if there was indeed interest. I did, and there was, and the rest is history.
In the making.
Yeah. The rest is going to be history.
Well, when John first mentioned this idea of time, then again, I have this kind of amnesia somehow about specific things in history, but I said, maybe can you write a libretto? Can you write something down? Can you see what does that actually mean to translate these abstract ideas into something tangible that the general public can really perceive, understand, and get emotionally involved with? And so he literally, I swear, 5 minutes later, I had an email with an absolutely brilliant idea about how to portray time that was witty, you know, deep, scientific, tangible, metaphoric power was embedded in it. And I was like, well, yes, we absolutely must do this project. And I realized the more I started thinking about time, it almost becomes, the most universal, profound thing that every single person experiences. And it affects everything from history to philosophy to how we perceive art, our own lives. And so it just suddenly was this vast topic that of great interest.
And at the same time, in the sciences, from cosmology to quantum mechanics to everyday life, time poses deep questions, deep unanswered questions that have profoundly influenced the way scientists go about their work. And there's a increasing, especially in recent years, an increasing interest in developing from just a scientific perspective a deeper understanding of the concept of time. And we thought that some of these scientific puzzles and enigmas, I think is a better word, could perhaps be expressible in dance form.
Well, we had a wonderful discussion that was really from ideas, historical ideas and contemporary ideas about music, dance, ballet, Navajo culture, and of course, time and the history of thought about time. So it was a vast dialogue in a very, you know, for me it was interesting because it was so personal and felt at the same time that it was delving deeply into a lot of ideas that are never articulated verbally, that we were searching for ways to describe a lot of things that have great paradox and are very enigmatic. So that was thrilling.
And in addition to the many domains, I don't want to call them disciplines exactly, within the arts, domains of composition and choreography and performance, in the sciences and more generally in the academic areas, the from the Greek philosophers to Newtonian mechanics to thermodynamics, relativity, quantum mechanics, biology, evolution, cultural anthropology, history, all of these fields have something to say and something to scratch their head about when it comes to time.
Yeah, and we were using all of those in a very compressed way, and they all, I think, have informed the way we are thinking about this project. Yeah. Yeah, we assembled a really incredible group of people. I, as the choreographer, John as the, ecologist, physicist. I mean, he has many caps that he wears as well. And then we had the composer, Gregory Spears, who is an extremely articulate examiner of the history of music and the techniques of music, and so we learned a lot about how time works in music. And then we had Jacques Soto, who is one of the greatest dancers who's ever lived, who I know from New York City Ballet, where he was a principal dancer. And he is a member of the Navajo Nation, grew up in, it's funny, his biography says Gallup, but he's been talking, I think he was born in Gallup, but he mainly grew up in Arizona and then ultimately in New York at a very young age. So we had these representations of all these various disciplines, all kind of, you know, circling around the ways of looking at time from various prisms. Well, I mean, it's wonderful to have a meeting like this where you can share information and get everybody informed by a common cultural and scientific perspective. And so we did really come together in seeing a vision for this production. But, you know, now the real work begins because, you know, writing the music, creating the choreography, and that's, you know, for the dance, that means being in the dance studio for 2 to 3 months, you know, working and finding a vocabulary that represents very complex ideas about time, how time works, the enigmas of time, et cetera. So the questions to be answered are really the translation of this conceptual material into a physical, sensual presence.
Well, I'll just talk about the crass dimension of the question, which is it's going to take a lot of financial support to pull this off. I think we have created a pathway to an amazing bridge between the arts and the sciences, something that in my lifetime I have not been able to witness, something so potentially exciting. But to do it is going to require a lot of fundraising.
And that makes me think of something, just because I think, you know, this idea of science and art coming together, which is very appealing to a lot of us. But, you know, I have been attacked by the dance critics in the New York Times for being so pretentious as to touch upon science. So there's such a suspicion. So, I mean, this is one of the things we have to overcome, are these kind of cultural inbuilt ideas.
And when I mentioned to a colleague that I was going to participate in this working group that would lead to the production of a ballet, the only question I got was, oh, I didn't know you could dance, which of course I can't. But it's interesting how different people's perceptions of what it means to for me to do this.
Well, that's also interesting because, you know, in the early, you know, kind of 18th and 19th century, dance really did have librettos, and they were written by poets or by philosophers, people like this. And so it seems entirely appropriate that in this case, our libretto is more conceptual than like a written kind of narrative, but that ultimately the real impulse for what we could call the libretto, the ideas that we are embodying, all come from a scientist.
If it meant something to me, it wouldn't be complex. But that's facetious. But I do feel sometimes that things we call complex are just the things we don't understand. And as we understand them at a more deep and deep level, they simplify. And we see the simplicity on what I call the other side of complexity by burrowing through the complexity to the far side. But we're not there yet with time. And from, at least from a scientific perspective, the complexity of time, in my view, is best expressed as the fact that different areas of science have different conceptions of time. And quantum physicists think about it differently, in some cases, from cosmologists, from thermodynamicists, from biologists. So the time has not yet achieved the status, even though time has been unified with space by Einstein. Time hasn't been unified with time.